Tell us, Arth, about yourself, your academic qualifications, your work experience, if any, and your main hobbies.
Sir, my name is Arth Jain. I was born in Jabalpur, Madhya Pradesh. In 2004, I shifted to New Delhi, from where I did my schooling through Sanskriti School. Post that, I did my BTech in Mechanical Engineering from IIT Delhi. My hobbies include playing chess and engaging in debating. And sir, I do not have any work experience.
So tell me, Arth, I am a bit curious to know, with the IIT Delhi tag and with BTech in Mechanical Engineering and you being so young, technology is upswing, IITians are in demand. Now, what brings you to, get attracted towards civil services?
Sir, when I contrasted a job in core mechanical sector to civil services, I felt I would enjoy the diversified civil services job more than a specialized engineering job. The appeal was mostly around the prestige and the meaningful career that civil services offer, along with the opportunities and diversity, along responsibilities at a very young age, sir.
But Arth, you have not had any work experience on this side. How did you know, unless you worked with some organization in private sector, and then maybe you had compared with the civil services, what gave you this insight?
Sir, one of the major factors was my father's own career, which had been a major source of inspiration. Other than that, sir, the decision was taken in second year of college, where I had to choose what I want to do in life. So I thought there is no need to waste time as well as energy in a sector I may not like. Instead, I should work towards the goal that I am attracted to, sir.
So what do you think are the strong points of civil services?
Sir, I think civil services today remains a very prestigious career. It offers one the opportunity to work in multiple sectors, right from education to health to agriculture. And this kind of diversity may not be available in any other, may not be available in most of the jobs. It offers a structured career growth, sir. We can contrast it to, let's say, working in an NGO, which also offers that same satisfaction, but not the structured career growth.
Arth, I have seen in my service period in the IAS, that many IITians in our own cadre, after doing some 10, 15 years of service in the IAS, then they have left. Maybe they did not find the civil services very compatible to the kind of learning they had, the kind of background they had. So you think that this possibility could be there in your case also?
Sir, it's difficult for me to say what will happen 15 years down the line. I can only make my decision based on what I prefer today, what I want to achieve today. Sir, there is no guarantee how my thinking will shape up in the next 15 years, sir.
So tell me, you are from Madhya Pradesh, Arth. Madhya Pradesh claims that their vaccination drive is a big success. So sir, in what manner you think that their claim is correct, number one, and how do you think Madhya Pradesh has been able to do this, achieve this feat compared to other states?
Sir, about the first part, I am not able to recall the exact numbers, the average number of vaccinations per week. But when it did begin in June 21, Madhya Pradesh had one of the highest contributions. So to answer the second part, I think a general strategy to tackle COVID has been based on two different parameters. One, sir, they have formed district level management committees. So there is the SP, DM, as well as a divisional commissioner and IG in that committee. And this has decentralized the response and allowed ramping up of capacity extremely fast. Second is, sir, the campaigns they have been running, right? From I Am Corona volunteer campaign to Kill Corona campaign, because of which a lot of civil society members have been associated, and this has allowed expansion of vaccination, sir, rapidly.
Afghanistan is still a big puzzle. The situation is still very fluid. Now, how do you assess the strategy of India at this point in time vis-a-vis Afghanistan?
So India is right now following somewhat of a wait and watch strategy, and I feel that is the correct thing to do. There are a lot of uncertainties. Some people have said that maybe we could be involved militarily in Afghanistan, but there are strong counter arguments to that. What is being said is that we should appoint an envoy who can directly engage with Taliban. And as per reports, we have been engaging with Taliban. So the recognition being given to Taliban as well as the approach of engaging with them is the correct thing to do, sir. That is what I feel.
But Arth, we haven't seen any signs or any news reports about India, getting into a dialogue with Taliban, which is known to the international community also. China has done it. We have been seeing photographs of Chinese foreign minister, talking to Taliban and representative. US also is in clear open dialogue. We haven't heard India having a dialogue with Taliban. Have you?
So I would say there are three aspects to it. First, the dialogues that have taken place have been through back channel. So these have only been reported in media, and these are not official MEA statements. Secondly, sir, the reason might be that our stand has always been to not to negotiate with any form of terrorism. And during 1996 to 2001, when Taliban was in power, we did not have good relations with them. The IC-814 hijack and our support towards Northern Alliance. And the third aspect is, sir, this is exactly what is being pointed out, that we have to appoint a formal envoy who can put forward our views as well as our concerns, sir.
So, Arth, I pass on to Mr. Khanna. He will take the next round of questions.
Sir.
Arth, I can see you had mathematics as your optional and debating and chess are your hobbies.
Yes, sir.
And you are from IIT Delhi.
Yes, sir.
All right. So, just coming to debating, let me give you a topic and see how you react to it in 2 minutes. And topic is, India has too much of democracy.
Sir, which side do I have to represent, the pro or the off?
You can debate on both the sides. You select your side.
So first I'll go with for the motion that India does have too much democracy. So the different arguments that can be given is that when we contrast it to other developing countries, India has been taking a very liberal approach towards any form of dissent. What this translates into is that a lot of foreign intervention takes place. For example, any of the Kudam Kolam protests to Vedanta protests, this has been made possible because India gives a lot of scope for dissent. As well as, sir, we have multitude of parties, different political parties can voice their opinion on different matters. So I would say that a thriving debating environment is there because we have too much democracy. So now I'll shift to against the motion. And I'll say that India may not have too much democracy as is claimed. And this might be because recent instances of, let's say, use of sedition or use of UAPA have been done. And some commentators feel this is to silence dissent. Even the new IT rules that have come, some believe that it will only compromise on the democratic credentials. So there are arguments for too much democracy and against too much democracy.
Good. You said you do not know where you will be 15 years from now. Why did you make that statement? Because that raises certain questions. So are you doubtful that you will continue in civil services?
Sir, by that statement, I only meant that I cannot be sure of where I'll be 15 years down the line. At present, I feel that I will definitely be within service and a part of it, and I do not see any situation where I would have to leave it. But that being said, no one can predict what happens in the next 15 years. What happens in anyone's life can't be predicted, sir.
So my question is again the same. Where do you see yourself 15 years from now?
Sir, ask.
Think and reply.
Sir, I see myself in the civil services. Personally, my ambition would be that I can get into civil services and I can build a reputation of being a very good officer, someone who's dynamic, someone who has an energetic approach towards things. In my personal sphere, I would want a life that I want to be living a meaningful and healthy life and ensure the same for friends and family around me, sir.
Good. Setting targets for society and achieving them. You know, in 15 years, you can set targets and try and achieve those targets. That is how you plan your, you know, life. And then you take it as it comes. But stick to the targets. And where do you see India in next 15 years?
Sir, India is an emerging superpower and is continuing to, let's say, it will emerge as a very it will have a very dominant role in the global arena. I think economically we would grow right now in PPP terms. We are the third largest and our economy will be growing at a rapid rate. A lot of technological changes would take place. Newer technologies would come. Governance would improve as well as in the social sector, let's say in the quality of education as well as the quality of healthcare being given. I see massive changes taking place.
Good. I would have expected something more on the front of you know, when you imagine India, you imagine India in totality with respect to population, with respect to relations. So anyway, this you can think about it.
Sir.
Condense your reply in 2 minutes to project. My next question is on mathematics. What do you think has been contribution by Indians in the field of mathematics?
Sir, in modern day or overall?
Overall.
Sir, from ancient history to medieval history, we have had many mathematicians. So I will start quoting some examples like Aryabhatta and Brahmagupta, who gave the idea of zero. And we had Bhaskar I and Bhaskar II, who worked in fields of astronomy. We had Bodhayan, who worked in the field of geometry. We had Hemchandra as well as Pingala, who worked in field of binary numbers and Fibonacci numbers. Now, when I come to modern day, we have had mathematicians like Shakuntala Devi, who showed their skills to the world. We had Ramanujan, who gave a lot of theories, his whole Ramanujan conjecture. Then we had mathematicians like D.R. Kaprikar, as well as Narendra Karmarkar, who gave the Karmarkar's algorithm.
Good. Very good. Now, talking about Madhya Pradesh, what are the UNESCO heritage sites prevalent in Madhya Pradesh? Can you quickly name them?
So there are three sites, Bhimbetka, Sanchi and Khajuraho.
And Khajuraho, has it got anything to do with mathematics?
I am not sure, sir.
So look up the records.
Sir, I will.
Khajuraho is the first instance of zero appearing in the world.
I did not know this.
So there is a temple, Jain temple and
Parshvanath temple.
There is a magic square. And for the first time, they say zero appeared there. So that is the significance. Okay. You are a mechanical engineer. Tell me about assemble in India, make in India. Which one is better for achieving Atmanirbhar Bharat?
Sir, as far as I am aware, assemble in India is about being part of the global supply chains. So we take the primary products and we manufacture or we process it into the secondary products. That is the idea, especially for white appliances like electronics. Make in India is about attracting investment into the country so that can increase the domestic manufacturing. As to the question, which is better for Atmanirbhar Bharat, I think, sir, both of them will go hand in hand. We have to be a part of global supply chains, as well as we have to attract investment into the country. That will increase our domestic capability and hence our self-reliance.
If you were posted in a district in Madhya Pradesh, what steps would you take for doubling the farmer's income?
So understanding the basic causes of stress, I think the few measures that can be taken. One is, sir, marketing reforms. So that would be transportation logistics can be smoothened by providing, let's say, tractor renting facilities. Second, sir, the storehouse logistics. So by increasing warehouse facilities as well as cold storage. Third would be, sir, a stronger procurement mechanism. So motivating farmers to form farmer producer organizations, which can help them bargain for a better price. So the other aspects are ending the technology fatigue in agriculture by making them aware of newer technologies like space tech, nanotech, biotech. Second, sir, shifting towards crops that are suited to the climatic conditions, like in a drought-prone area, telling farmers about millets and pulses instead of them growing rice, which is a water-intensive crop. So these are the steps that can be taken.
Okay, thank you. Over to you, Mr. Sumesh. Thank you,
sir.
Good afternoon.
Yes, good afternoon, Arth. Okay, I heard your views on Atmanirbhar Bharat. Okay, can you tell me the performance of 8 core industries in recent times?
Sir, I'm not aware of the exact data, sir.
Okay, so can you name the 8 core industries?
Sir, refinery products, electricity, steel, crude oil, natural gas, fertilizers, coal, and cement.
Okay. Over 21 million people lost jobs in tourism industry. So can you suggest some structural reforms to revive it?
Sir, I think immediate revival would be based around how far COVID curve can be flattened. So once the COVID curve is flattened using increase in vaccination, then we can slowly start opening up different tourist hotspots. Here, what we have to do is enforce COVID appropriate behavior so that again, the site does not close down. That is the main prerequisite so that people do not lose their jobs. So the other factor is ensuring social distancing and all. More than that, I think now we have to start attracting people towards these tourist hotspots. So we have to focus on improving the basic amenities and basic infrastructural facilities, as well as on better advertising. Right now, people have experienced a lot of COVID fatigue and they're more than ready to go out. So this offers a lot of potential. We just have to tap into this potential and attract people towards India.
RBI is planning to launch a new digital currency. Can you tell of it?
Sir, I'm not aware of the exact details.
Okay. So what is your view on the future of cryptocurrency in India?
Sir, at present, the future seems very uncertain because of the RBI stand that it does not recognize it as a legal tender. And the February 12th circular, which had banned cryptocurrency, showed that RBI is very averse towards cryptocurrency at present. That being said, sir, in the future, cryptocurrency may hold a lot of potential because cryptocurrency, by its default, it's very transparent, it's non-hackable, and can be used for transactions in the future. So after we get a policy framework, the increase use of cryptocurrency may increase.
Okay. Can you tell me the role of election commission in free and fair elections? And I would like to know your comment on the performance of the election commission in recently concluded elections.
Sir, Election Commission of India has been given powers under Article 324, RBA 1950 and RBN 1951 to take action against different parties to enforce the model code of conduct and to ensure that no laws are broken during elections. So through these powers given to it, it aims to ensure free and fair elections. Secondly, sir, my opinion would be that there have been controversies over the fairness because of the way in which the election commissioner is appointed. It is appointed unilaterally by the center government. Secondly, sir, the whole conducting elections during COVID second wave also became slightly controversial. So because of these aspects, EC has slightly been controversial. But overall, sir, there is nothing to say that any freedom or fairness has been compromised upon.
Okay. I pass on to Chairman, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Sumesh.
Welcome.
So, Earth, this conflict between Assam and Mizoram states, you have heard about it?
Yes, sir.
Now, just apprise us as to what exactly is the basic reason and why it is like this. Then maybe I'll ask a supplementary question subsequent to that.
So the basis is they have a 165 kilometer border, and the border settlement has not been accepted by both. So Mizoram accepts the 1875 notification in which the Mizo society was consulted. Assam, on the other hand, follows the 1933 notification, which is rejected by Mizoram. Because of this, the two notifications are inherently inconsistent, and this has led to frequent border clashes.
So tell me, Assam that way has got similar dispute with three more northeastern states. So what do you think should be the way forward to resolve this dispute? Who could initiate, and how do you think this should be resolved within the constitutional framework of the country?
Sir, I feel that a resolution of issue would be done by addressing the core issue, that is the border settlement. So a border settlement has to take place, and it has to be accepted by all the stakeholders involved. This can be initiated by the central government, which can act as a mediator, because independently both the states might not be able to come to a consensus.
Mm-hmm. You think that judiciary could also play a role in this?
Definitely, sir. If judiciary or the central government, basically any organ that is away from the state politics and that is seen as impartial to either of the states, can play a role.
So, Earth, we have covered quite a few areas the last 30 minutes. Now, yes. The last question, Earth, would be a question from the subject of your choice, if you wish. So tell me any, and maybe I will try to ask the question.
Sir, from any hobby, chess or debating, or from my optional maths or mechanical, I think.
Okay, debating, I think, has already been asked by Mr. Khanna. So, I mean, when you think of chess, you think of Vishwanath Anand. Now, recently, Vishwanath Anand was able to thrash one of the world chess champions just about a month ago. Are you aware of that contest?
No, sir.
Now, tell me how this legacy or Vishwanath Anand, you know, is now almost more than 20-25 years he's been in this tournament or in this game. Now, how does this baton of, you know, chess, like India has been a leader to the next generation? You think that we are having a good next generation who would be as good, if not better than Vishwanath Anand?
Sir, Vishwanath Anand, sir, did bring about a chess revolution, and I think the next generation is fantastic, extremely good. So, for example, in women, we have strong players like Koneru Hampi. In men, we have extremely strong players like Vidit Gujarati, P. Hari Krishna, Praganand, and Nihal Sarin. These are emerging players. So I would say that while there was one Vishwanath Anand 30 years back, now there will be multiple Vishwanath Anands in the years to come.
So, Earth, we finish our formal interview now.